So it really does. I'm really pleased to have the opportunity to introduce Johanna Varner as the first Ecology Center lecturer of 2019. Johanna remembers, I did not. We first met apparently on a bus in 2013 going to the Ecological Society of America meeting in Minneapolis. But what I really remember was the following year we were both on a science communication Ignite talk. And many of you have seen Ignite talks, maybe not, they're not called Inspire. They're 5 minutes and you really don't have much time to be able to present much. And we were both on the program and I heard Joe's talk. I was like, oh wow, this is so cool. I would really like, and she's in from Utah, because at that time she was a doctoral student at the University of Utah. I would really like to be able to get her to come up to Utah State University. And now here it is, 4.5 years later, we're finally getting it. It's the first time that she's been able to come to USU. And so, not because of me, but because of all the students who wanted to invite her. But I think you will all be very pleased. I need to tell you a little bit about Jo. She's got a bachelor's and master's degrees from MIT, and the master's was in biological engineering, and then something happened, something clicked, and she said, that's not quite it. And so she came over to ecology and got her ecology degree at the University of Utah, finished in 2015, but she was already very excited about citizen science. She had incorporated it in her dissertation research. She was very excited about science communication. So the next thing she did was a AAAS media fellowship working at KQED Radio, which is the National Public Radio affiliate in San Francisco. And so she did that for a while, and then at the beginning of 2016, moved to Colorado Mesa University, where she's an assistant professor, teaching things like mammalogy and animal behavior and ecology and evolution and general biology. She has, well, I've got a bunch of other things on here, but the one thing that I think is important, the most important, is that she is good enough at what she does that in 2018 she received the Early Career Award for Public Engagement with Science from the American Association for the Advancement of Science. And so it is with great pleasure that I ask you to welcome Johanna Varner.
Can you guys hear me okay? I know I don't usually speak with a microphone, so this is sort of big time. Thank you, Mark, so much for the introduction, and thank you guys so much for inviting me to be here today. I'm super, super excited to come and see Utah State. As Mark mentioned, I actually grew up in Salt Lake City, and I did my dissertation for my PhD at University of Utah, and although I've been to Logan several times, I've never actually been to Utah State campus, and so this is a real treat. Today's talk, I wanted to tell you guys a little bit about some of the public engagement work that I've done, and also just a little sort of broad overview of citizen science in general. And so to do that, I think it's, you know, Mark already sort of gave you a little bit of an introduction about me, but I just kind of wanted to fill in a couple of the gaps there because I think it's sort of important in terms of my journey and how I got to be interested in this sort of thing. So as Mark mentioned, I did my undergraduate and master's at MIT. And at MIT, I learned a lot of really important things about science and how to do research. But my research at the time really focused on a couple of sort of small-scale systems. I worked on C. elegans genetics of neuronal development, which are these tiny little nematode worms. Super powerful genetic tools, really glad that somebody studies them. I spent a lot of time in a cold, dark room by myself watching cells divide in worms, which is about as exciting as it sounds. And so I tried to kind of switch gears a little bit to do a master's in engineering. I worked on these microfluidic devices which resulted in also spending a lot of time in a cold, dark room by myself. And so the part of my introduction that said something happened, I decided to come back to Salt Lake City. I worked at a bakery, and I traveled to New Zealand, and I worked on organic farms. So here I am selling plums. And I did a lot of backpacking and a lot of hiking, and I learned a lot about sort of the kinds of species, human species interactions and human environment interactions that have really shaped the landscape and the history of New Zealand, and started to put together that science really could be done outside of the laboratory. So when I came back to the States, I was back working in the bakery, and I read a newspaper article about pikas, which are these small mammals. They're closely related to rabbits. They're super adorable, and they live in the mountains. And I had always been really in love with pikas from growing up in the Wasatch. I decided to contact the scientist that was interviewed in that article and ask her, how one becomes a pika scientist. And she offered me a job as a technician in her lab working with deer mice and hantavirus, and then ultimately allowed me to transition into being a graduate student studying pikas. Along the way, I had this experience at KQED through the Mass Media Fellowship, which is a really fantastic experience. If any of you have questions about that fellowship outside of this talk, I'd be happy to tell you more about that. But along this journey, one of the things that really stood out to me is that as I interacted with people in different capacities as a scientist, I discovered that there's oftentimes a real disconnect between how people interpret scientists and how scientists wish to be interpreted and how we wish for our science to be interpreted. And specifically, what I started to see is that, you know, people really hold their own beliefs about what is truth, and it's oftentimes very difficult to, you know, introduce some new piece of evidence that challenges those beliefs. So when we think about how people search for truth out there in the world, in many cases, scientists aren't actually considered to be by people to be the authority on science. Many people instead rely on learning about science through places like their religion or places like politics. And so the social sciences actually tell us that people in general use 5 basic sources of evidence in trying to evaluate their own truth. These sources include things like authority, customs or traditions, their own personal experience or deductive reasoning, and then, of course, scientific inquiry, which many of us scientists consider sort of the gold standard of how to learn about truth. And so when designing my PhD projects, one of the things I was really interested in was also including, you know, a significant outreach component and trying to figure out how we could be more effective as scientists at interfacing with the public. And so during this time, citizen science was really just starting to become a sort of field unto itself. And what I really liked about citizen scientists, or about citizen science as a outreach opportunity, is that it kind of integrated these ideas of personal experience and scientific inquiry. And specifically by trying to give people their own personal experiences in doing science and engaging in scientific inquiry. Just for those of you guys for whom this may be sort of a new term, the Oxford English Dictionary recently defined citizen science as scientific work that is undertaken by members of the general public, often in collaboration with or under the direction of professional scientists or scientific institutions. So citizen science in general, it invites the public to participate in science. Oftentimes that's through data or sample collection. It could be through recording the locations of different species or collecting samples that are sent into a lab to be analyzed. Sometimes citizen science can have to do with content processing. This is one of my most favorite citizen science projects that I have participated in. It's a project in Antarctica with camera trap data, and what you do is you go and make a profile on this website and log in, and whenever there's a picture with a penguin in it, you click on all the penguins. You know, so you just click, 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 and what it does is it really helps the scientist identify exactly how many penguins are in the picture. But for you as a person, you're like, yay, penguin! and so, this can be an example of a content processing kind of science project, and then in some occasions, volunteers are invited to participate in the generation of questions and the analysis of the data. And I'll talk about that a little bit later. As just a brief side note, I also wanted to recognize that many of you guys may have heard of this as participatory science or as crowdfunded science. Community science is becoming sort of more of a common term, and that's just because the word citizen, particularly in today's highly politicized world, folks who practice citizen science want to be sure that it's inclusive of people who don't hold a U.S. passport. So again, not about U.S. passports, more about engaging a broader range of people and trying to be inclusive. I will continue to use the word citizen science throughout this talk just because that's sort of what the field has come to be known as, but just know that that definition is not exclusive of people who are not U.S. citizens. So just to give you kind of an overview of what I wanted to talk about today, I'm going to start by giving you a little overview of the field of citizen science in general, of its history, and of its sort of current breadth and depth. I then will spend most of the time today talking about PICAs in citizen science, and specifically telling you about two different PICA citizen science initiatives that I was involved with from the time that I started my PhD and still am involved with now. And then finally, I'll sort of wrap up by acknowledging some of the realities of citizen science and some of the future directions of the field. So when we think about citizen science, I think that many people think of this as sort of like a burgeoning new field that is engaging members of the public in science. But we oftentimes forget that actually observations of amateur naturalists is how science itself started. So it wasn't actually until about the late 19th century that it was actually possible to make a living entirely as being a scientist. And prior to that, most of the scientific records that we have were actually people who were doing science and collecting observations on the side, but also had a different job that paid them money. Some of the earliest records that we could consider to be kind of citizen science records come from the French winemakers who have been collecting data on the phenology of grape harvest for several centuries, and Japanese court diarists who have been recording the dates of cherry blossom blooming for over a millennium. There's also a tremendous amount of really foundational records in ecology that come from trappers, hunters, and other sportsmen. And in particular, some of the records from the fur industry have led to some of the really foundational ecological theory underlying predator-prey dynamics and cycling. So one of the sort of first formal citizen science projects was the Christmas bird count. And the Christmas bird count was started in 1900 by Frank Chapman, who was the American Museum of Natural History's ornithologist. And in 1900, Frank Chapman started the Christmas bird count as essentially an alternative to the typical activities with birds that happen during Christmas, which is shooting them and eating them. And so he said, how about if we just count them instead? And so the Christmas bird count has now been going on for over 100 years. And in 2018, the Christmas bird count actually engaged over 70,000 volunteers across 2,400 different locations throughout the U.S., Canada, West Indies, Pacific Islands, and even parts of South America. So on Christmas Day of 2018, close to 60 million birds were identified and counted around the world as part of this program. Today, citizen science projects span the range of all kinds of disciplines that extend far outside of ecology. This is an example of a project that you could participate in for astrophysics, where you can help to classify galaxy images from telescope imagery, and even into molecular biology. This is a game where you can help scientists learn how proteins are actually folded into three-dimensional structures. So some of these projects also sort of verge on gaming, in that there are you can earn points by participating in the project. There are competitive leaderboards. So for those of you who need a new goal in life, you could aspire to be a pro protein folder if you're looking for something new to do. A big step in formalizing the discipline was the formation of the Citizen Science Association. And the Citizen Science Association was formally established in 2013, and its first conference was really held in 2015. So this may not sound like that big of a deal, but I think that we oftentimes, as scientists, take for granted our scientific societies, things like the Ecological Society of America, as a place for gathering and sharing of ideas and an outlet for publishing our results. And so the fact that the CSA was formed by people quite recently, I think, is pretty significant. They now operate a peer-reviewed journal that evaluates the practice of citizen science itself. They hold a biannual national conference. The next one will be in 2019 in Raleigh, North Carolina. And they operate a listserv and several different discussion fora where practitioners can get together, exchange ideas, and talk about progress and challenges that they are encountering on their own. So citizen science practitioners now basically group projects into three kind of broad categories. And these are obviously not mutually exclusive, but they do sort of, I think, share for you the kind of key goals that are oftentimes sought by people who organize citizen science projects. The ones that are probably most familiar to you or most relevant to the ecological sciences are those that have to do with conservation, management, and restoration. And in many cases, these are the kinds of projects that are driven by decision support needs. So we don't know how this species is doing in this habitat. You know, we need to collect more information about air quality, water quality, et cetera, in order to make decisions. Sometimes citizen science projects can be motivated by basic science and by seeking scientific knowledge. They're therefore driven by a scientific question and oftentimes have a lot of very elaborate data quality control in order to ensure that the data collected are of publishable quality. And then finally, a number of citizen science projects are oftentimes established with the sort of explicit goal of having a positive educational experience for the volunteers that are involved. So the quality of the data may not be quite as important, but instead the learning opportunity and the experience that the volunteers get about learning about the process of scientific inquiry would be the key goal. I'll talk in a little bit about some of the sort of trying to balance these objectives in some of the PICA projects that I've done. I wanted to wrap up this survey of citizen science by just mentioning that the advent of smartphone technology has really revolutionized this field, basically because almost everybody carries around these like super powerful devices in their pockets. It's allowed a lot of citizen science projects to integrate all of their training materials through multimedia into the app. So you can train people with photos or, for example, songs or videos or instructional material that can all be accessed in the app. App collection also can automate metadata, so you don't have to ask volunteers to record the date, time, their GPS location, or the weather because the app already records those things for them. And it makes it much easier for observations to be collected and transmitted, things like photos or sounds. There are also some kinds of inexpensive accessories that you can buy for your phone that will allow you to, for example, make water quality measurements or to collect samples or to take macro photography pictures of very small things like insects. And then one last thing about smartphones is that they also allow for data validation. So automatically there can be filters set on the data that are transmitted where experts can then review and flag anomalous observations. A couple of the apps that are perhaps you may be familiar with in ecology, one of the biggest and most broad app is iNaturalist. This is a little map of Grand Junction, and that's where my house is in Grand Junction. And I just pulled up like, you know, what people have observed nearby. What you can see here is that it collects a georeferenced data point of, you know, all sorts of different kinds of species of plants, animals, you know, lichen, fungi, et cetera. As of 2019, iNaturalist was acquired by the California Academy of Science, and who now operates and runs it. There are about 15 million research-grade observations. So these are observations that have been vetted by the community on iNaturalist. And of 180 species, these data have been used in 114 publications. And while that may sound super impressive, it sort of pales in comparison to the eBird app, which is administered by the Cornell Lab of Ornithology, a real leader in this field. eBird is sort of the Cadillac of citizen science apps, and it really takes advantage of how sort of compulsive birders can be. basically, it makes it easy to identify birds by their habitat type, by, you know, where they're found, by what color they are, et cetera. And then it allows birders to basically check when and where they see a bird. And so that you can basically maintain like your bird life list in your phone. But then that life list is also transmitted to the Cornell Lab of Ornithology and is freely available for scientists to analyze. So as of the end of the year in 2018, eBird has engaged 420,000 birders. They've collected 590 million observations. And the data in eBird has been used in 220 peer-reviewed publications, 45 of which were published just this past year. And so what you can see is that these are really sort of accelerating in terms of a way of for ecologists to be able to access a really broad data set about a wide range of taxa. All right, that's enough about birds. It's time to move on to cute mammals. And today I'm going to tell you about two citizen science projects on pikas that I have had the pleasure of being a part of. I wanted to give you a very brief background about pika natural history and why this species is a really good model for citizen science. And if you're interested in this, I would encourage you to come to my technical talk tomorrow. I'll talk a lot more about pika natural history in a changing world. So American pikas, they're small mammals. As I mentioned, they're closely related to rabbits, although they resemble more closely a cross between a guinea pig and a potato. They have a really restricted distribution, and they are limited to these high elevation boulder fields. This is a picture of a pika habitat on Mount Timpanogos in Utah County. And in Utah, we typically find pikas living in these high elevation boulder fields above about 8,000 to 9,000 feet in elevation. As a result of a number of factors, pikas have been shown to be sensitive to climate change in parts of their range. And specifically, this is because they have this restricted distribution and very tight association with talus habitats, as well as a limited ability to disperse between patches of habitat, which makes it difficult for populations to recolonize a patch of habitat that has gone locally extinct as a result of any number of factors. In addition, pikas are sensitive to high temperatures. And so together, these factors, along with the fact that we've seen some steep population declines in parts of their range, pikas were petitioned for listing under the Endangered Species Act in 2009. And ultimately, they were denied listing because there was insufficient evidence of how climate change was affecting pikas across their whole range, as opposed to just the Great Basin. And so that listing decision actually spurred a really big involvement or interest in the pika community in trying to engage volunteers in helping to collect monitoring data across the entire range of the species. And it turns out that for a number of reasons, pikas are actually ideal for citizen science. So one of the things that makes them really a good fit for this is that they are diurnal. They're active during the day. You don't have to have any sort of special equipment in order to be able to observe them. They also have really clearly well-defined habitat features. So, you know, if you're in a rainforest, you're unlikely to see pikas. You really need to go to a rock slide. They also are conspicuous, and they're highly detectable. If a pika is present, it is really likely that you'll be able to detect it. And they're really difficult to confuse with any other animals that live in the same kind of habitat. They also live in really popular natural areas, places that people like to go recreate anyway. And then, of course, the most important thing is that they are charismatic and they are totally adorable. So just in case anybody was wondering, in 2008, there was a very highly controlled, highly scientific study in the form of a survey that went out to different mammal biologists to vote on their cutest mammal. And pikas were, in fact, voted to be the cutest mammal of all the mammals. So just in case there's any questions about that, we've settled that. Now, it may seem as though pikas live far away and that you'd need to be some sort of superhuman mountaineer in order to be able to reach them. But in fact, with a careful site selection, pika science can actually be quite inclusive. There are lots of different sites that are very easily accessible from the road via short hikes or even visible from the road. This is my grandma. She had to be sitting on a phone book in order to even see out the window because she's so tiny. But this is her observing pikas in the Uintas near my family's cabin and contributing to our pika research. So I have done a lot of work with seventh grade students in particular, not particularly well known for their interest in endurance hiking. We were able to select sites that seventh graders could really reliably access. So that, as I mentioned, that ESA listing decision really sparked widespread interest in this species. And as a result, there are lots of different groups that are actively engaging pikas, engaging volunteers in monitoring pikas. This is a map of some of those projects. There are a number of other projects that have in the past collected data but have shut down due to funding reasons, and we'll talk about that in a minute. One of the big contributions that volunteers have made is collecting range-wide observations and presence observations of pikas. So this is actually a map of all of the observations that were collected by volunteers and entered into iNaturalist that are being currently used in a range-wide analysis of how climate affects pika distribution across their entire range. And this paper is actually under review right now at Nature Climate Change and includes several thousand presence points that were actually collected as part of citizen science projects. Another really valuable aspect of these citizen science projects to our understanding of pika ecology and distribution is that sometimes volunteers are more likely to identify unusual and interesting phenomena. So a couple of quick stories about examples of this. There was a citizen science project going on in Montana through the Craighead Institute, which is based in Bozeman. And a volunteer came back from that and said, you know, I've saw a black pika. And the you know, the woman who organizes it is like, okay, whatever, you know, like probably it was just a brown pika. And they were like, no, it's black. And indeed, it's a black pika. And a couple of other, you know, volunteers have identified black pikas throughout their range because it's really, you know, an unusual thing, and has led to some research, some genetics research into the frequency and probability of melanism in the species that might not otherwise have occurred had it not been for that observation by that volunteer. Another great example of this is that there was a project going on in Jackson Hole, Wyoming, where a volunteer reported that they had seen pikas building hay piles outside of the talus. And so again, of course, the pika scientists are like, okay, well, we'll see about that. And in fact, it was true that in this particular area in the Snake River Gorge, the pikas were extensively using off-talus habitat in down logs and in tree cavities to build their winter food caches. And so on a follow-up study, actually, there were a couple of scientists who discovered then they placed temperature sensors in these sort of unusual down wood habitats as well as in the closest talus patches. And what they found is that these down wood habitats actually offer a significant thermal buffering advantage over the talus habitats. And so this is another great example of a discovery that wouldn't have happened, you know, because pika scientists don't look for pikas outside of talus because we know better. But volunteers don't and can lead to these exciting discoveries. So today I'm going to tell you about these two projects, one that I did in Utah in the Uintas in collaboration with a middle school in Salt Lake City, and then a second little story about the Cascades Pika Watch program in Oregon, in which I will tell you a little bit more about in my talk tomorrow. So when I started graduate school in 2010, I started out in a fellowship in 2010 that put me in K-12 classrooms. So it was part of the old NSF GK-12 program, for those of you who may remember that. And it was designed to help give graduate students some experience working in K-12 classrooms and learning about the education system. And so as part of my rotation on that, I worked with the Salt Lake Center for Science Education, a middle school in Salt Lake, and in particular with these two really fabulous teachers, Diane Krim and Nikki Hack. And the two of them were very excited about pikas. They really loved pikas, and they really wanted to design some kind of pika project and that could be used to help them teach some of the science standards. And it turns out that the Uinta Mountains in northern Utah actually harbor a unique subspecies of pikas. There's only five currently recognized subspecies of pikas. One of them is found entirely and only in the Uinta Mountains in northern Utah. And so we started a program that we called Uinta's Pika Watch, in which we would engage students from SLCSE in monitoring a subset of sites in the Uintas and along an elevational gradient, with the idea that we would be able to start collecting data and at the beginning of the project be able to make comparisons between sites along an elevational gradient, but as time went on, we would also be able to look at longitudinal patterns of pika occupancy and temperatures at these sites. So we selected four sites in the Uinta Mountains along the Mirror Lake Highway. This is a picture of the Mirror Lake Highway, and just for those of you who aren't familiar with the Uintas, they're found just right here east of Salt Lake City. And we picked these sites as places that were easily accessible within, you know, a couple hundred meters of the road so that we would be able to take a group of students up to the Uintas and then survey all of the sites within a day. And in addition, we also picked a second site at Secret Lake in Alta, which was a shorter drive and an easier place to visit with the whole class, an easier place to get the school bus to. And we took the entire seventh grade class up there at the beginning of each school year. And this experience sort of served as an opportunity for all of the students to learn what a pica was and to get a taste for pica research. And then a subset of those students would be able to go and visit the extra sites in the Uinta Mountains. This is one of my favorite pictures of our study site at Secret Lake, and what you can may have not noticed here is here's a pica, and here's the seventh grade class doing whatever it is that seventh graders do over on the other side of the lake. I think they were eating lunch or something. So at each of these sites, we taught all of the students how to identify picas and how to estimate their abundance based on site calls and their hay pile signs. We also taught the students how to place temperature sensors that would record the temperatures that were relevant to the species down underneath the talus and in their rocky habitats. And we taught them how to survey vegetation resources that might be a key food source for these animals and might be subject to change. So what you're looking at here, these are pictures of some of our highest and lowest elevation sites in the Uinta Mountains. And our lowest site along that gradient was at 8,000 feet. Our highest one was at 11,000 feet. And we began these monitoring activities in 2001. So what we're looking at here is the first 5 years of our monitoring data. And what you can see is that starting in 2013, the students observed that the lowest elevation site no longer had any picas, at least for those 3 years. I think they came back in 2017 and then were gone again in 2018. So the students then had to return to the data that they had collected in order to try and hypothesize some explanations for this loss of picas. So what you're looking at here is a time trace of temperatures collected in 2013. And on the y-axis, you have the temperature in Celsius. On the x-axis, you have the date of the year. And this red site represents the temperatures measured at the low elevation site. The blue line represents the temperatures measured at the high elevation site. So the students went into the temperature data, and one of the things that they noticed without having been told by me was that the lower elevation site may have had some more extreme temperatures. There were warmer temperatures during the summer and actually colder temperatures during the winter as a result of a lack of consistent snowpack cover, which actually buffers the picas against cold temperatures. Just as a side note, this is now actually a pretty impressive data set. We now have about almost 8 years of continuous recording at each of these sites, and we'll soon be able to start looking at time trends in temperatures at these sites in the microclimates. So the students then worked in groups in school to come up with different kinds of projects analyzing their data. Some of them looked at temperature data, some of them looked at the occupancy data. There were a number of different other kinds of research projects. And we had the students present the results of their analyses in a special science fair that we called Pica Palooza. And we invited members of the University of Utah community, faculty, staff, students, parents, and other community members for these students. So for any of you guys who know any of the biology faculty at University of Utah, this gentleman here is Dave Bowling. He's actually a biophysical ecologist who studies temperature gradients, and he's grilling this seventh grade student about his temperature gradients along an elevational gradient. So I'm really pleased to report that I was terrified, but this student actually stood up to and withstood a pretty serious grilling from a, you know, another biophysical ecologist. My collaborators, Nikki and Diane, also had the students work in groups in the classroom to do some reflection activities. And this ranged from detailed instructions on how to draw a pica. Some groups had produced some detailed signage and brochures that could be put up at trailheads to educate hikers about picas. And this was some really touching poetry that, you know, it's much longer than this and it made me cry. One of the other things that we did that I think sort of made this project unique was that we did try to conduct an evaluation of the effectiveness of the project. So although we as scientists are constantly evaluating our own research, very few of us, I think, make any effort to evaluate our outreach efforts. And evaluation of outreach efforts is definitely really difficult, but I think it's very important for being able to identify shortcomings and be able to try and address and improve our projects. So one of the things that we did was we asked the kids, we gave the kids a short survey before and after the PICA experience, and which we asked them questions about sort of their identification, self-identification as a scientist, some environmental attitudes, some content knowledge, and also whether or not they believed that climate change was happening and was caused by humans. And we were really pleased to find that there was a significant shift in opinion following the PICA experience, in which more students believed in the scientific consensus on climate change. They also experienced an increase in pro-environmental attitudes and learned a significant amount of content knowledge about PICAs and mountain ecosystems. One last thing that I wanted to mention about this project is that, you know, of course, those seventh graders moved on and moved into high school. And one of the students that we had in seventh grade was this woman named Daniela Gonzalez. Daniela had participated in the PICA project as a seventh grader and was really interested in it. And she sought out an independent research experience through her school in high school, in which she designed and conceived of a study to look at stress hormones in scat along our elevational gradient and trying to look at, you know, perhaps whether or not the extinctions at low elevation that we were seeing were as a result of physiological stress. And so I mentored her in the lab, and then she went and did all of the analysis and presentation herself. She got to present her research, was selected actually for a very, very special science fair. For those of you who can't recognize this audience from the back, that is Dr. Jane Goodall. And she made a special visit to that to Salt Lake Center for Science Education, SLCSE, and Daniela was among the students that was selected to present her research to Dr. Jane. So as a side note, sometime you should ask me about my own conversation with Dr. Jane, because it was really hysterical. Okay, so I think one of the, you know, in the Uintas PICA Watch, some of the key aspects of the success of this project had to do with the local relevance of the project and the fact that students were really involved in the whole scientific process, not just collecting the data, but doing the analyses and even forming the questions themselves. I want to switch gears here and tell you a little bit about a project that I've been involved with in Oregon, the Cascades PICA Watch, and some of the research that's come out of that that has actually been really driven by volunteers. I'll talk more about this project in my talk tomorrow with respect to how this project is helping us to maintain our PICA monitoring program following a big fire in the Columbia Gorge. But suffice to say for right now that when I started doing my PhD research, a significant part of it took place in the Columbia River Gorge in Oregon and Washington. And I got involved with this group of really diverse group of folks that was really interested in monitoring PICAs in this area and in the broader Cascades. And so we set up a bunch of trainings. I worked with volunteers in training how to detect PICAs, and we developed a system for collecting and organizing and managing those observations. And two of the volunteers who participated in this project were these two guys, Shankar and Jonathan. And Shankar and Jonathan were just guys that lived in the Pacific Northwest that really dug wildlife, and they participated in several PICA Watch trips, and it turns out that they both are also software engineers who deal with a lot of content processing. And together they had this idea that they were friends, you know, from somewhere else, but they had this idea that we might be able to develop an algorithm to identify PICA calls from the spectrogram of ambient sound. And they came to me with this idea and said, you know, Joe, do you think we can do this? And I was like, well, yeah, I mean, I can't design an algorithm that does that, but you guys can, and I'll help you. And so they did. So it turns out that relative to other sounds that you might hear in the ambient noise in the Pacific Northwest, PICAs have a really unique, PICA calls have a really unique signature. Oops. And so for those of you who are not as good as Shankar and Jonathan at translating spectrograms into sound, PICA calls sound a little bit like sound a little bit like a dog chew toy, I think. And So Shankar and Jonathan wrote an algorithm to be able to identify the signature of a pica call through the spectrogram of ambient sound. And we trained the algorithm and then used it to on a preliminary analysis of about an hour of data from three sites in the Columbia Gorge. And what we found is that so far this appears to have really high sensitivity and high specificity, meaning that it is picking up most of the pica calls, and then most of the pica calls that it is picking up are indeed pica calls. We had a little bit of confusion with the, you know, on iPhones when you take a picture and it makes that little camera shutter sound. There were a couple of times that the algorithm picked that up as a pica call, but they're working on sort of fixing that up and on tuning this algorithm to be able to pick up calls from picas that speak other pica dialects. One of the things that's really cool about this algorithm is that it's designed with open source building blocks on code that it runs on software that's freely available. And so rather than having to pay for some really expensive acoustic analysis software, our plan is to be able to sort of tune this up and then make it freely available to the PICA research community where it could have a couple of key contributions. So one of the things that I was really excited about with this, too, was that Jonathan and Shankar were interested in collaborating with me to share some of this work at the American Society of Mammalogists conference last year. And so the three of us put together a poster to share some of this work and the preliminary results. And so, you know, again, here we are on a poster, and my co-authors are not formal scientists, but in fact citizen scientists who had designed and conceived of this project themselves. So our sort of future directions, what we're working on with this project right now, we're currently trying to compare activity data as indexed by these audio recordings versus more sort of typical ways of monitoring picas and determining their activity budgets, things like camera traps or behavioral surveys. And we have a couple of different sites where we have simultaneous data that were collected by all three of these methods so that we can kind of look at how effective is this as like a high throughput and remote monitoring of behavior. We're also hoping to develop a way that we could use this technique to be able to confirm absences in citizen science surveys. So this is one of the big challenges of citizen science surveys for picas, is that very few people really want to go to a site and search really exhaustively and then not see a cute animal. Most of them wish to go to a site and see the cute animals and then come back and talk about how exciting that was. So it may be more effective to have them go and leave a recorder, go back and collect it a couple of days later, and then listen to see if you hear any picas. Lastly, we are currently working on preparing a publication to be able to share this technique with the broader PICA community. And again, this is a publication on which I would have co-authors that are not formally trained as scientists. So I think that's one of the really cool things about this project, is that it's an avenue of research that I would never have been involved in had it not been for this volunteer project. All right, so for the last couple of minutes of my talk, I wanted to sort of wrap up and tell you guys a little bit about some of the realities of citizen science and some of the future directions that we're looking at in PICAs and beyond. I think it's really important to acknowledge that there are some challenges in implementing this. And one of the first ones is that many scientists suffer from a misconception that citizen science is basically like free work, and that it's just like you just sort of like push the ball and then it just like rolls down the hill. And that's just simply not really the case. Volunteer coordination, management, and retention can be surprisingly costly. Most PICA citizen science projects require an annual operating budget of somewhere between $5,000 to $10,000 a year. Some of that money goes to paying a part-time seasonal volunteer coordinator who manages all of the logistics and all of the volunteer emails and all of the volunteer questions throughout the season. And you know, the investment in volunteer retention, you know, can make a really big difference too in keeping volunteers engaged in the project by providing thank you gifts, such as this adorable stuffed pica, and holding events both to like sort of kick off the season and to wrap up the season and share all of the data that were collected by the volunteers. Several projects also struggle a little bit with balancing objectives. This is something certainly that we've worked with, particularly because the Cascades Pica Watch is composed of such a diverse group of people that Some people think that the scientific objectives are the most important and that we should just really ask volunteers to go and work really, really, really hard, and it doesn't matter if they have fun. And then there's some people who are like, well, this is all about, you know, having volunteers have fun, and the data quality doesn't really matter. And so kind of trying to negotiate and find a way to balance those different objectives so that both of them could be achieved has been a part of our journey as a organization. A final reality and a challenge that I think is important to acknowledge is that some citizen science projects struggle to engage non-traditional audiences or to avoid reinforcing structural inequalities in education. So as is the case with most kinds of science communication and outreach that relies on voluntary participation, most volunteers that like come to scientists and are like, I want to do the science, are already, you know, well educated to some extent. They already value science. They already see it as an important contribution to society. Most of the time they are also in a more wealthy socioeconomic class. And so indeed, when we look at the distribution of volunteer collected observations and the programs that are collecting them, we're seeing that these are being collected by a lot of folks from the Bay Area, folks from the Front Range in Colorado and from places like Durango and Telluride, folks from Jackson Hole. These are observations that were collected by folks from primarily Bozeman and Missoula that are involved in the Craighead Institute project, and folks from places like Seattle and Portland. And not only are these observations like not really encompassing the whole range of PICA distribution, but they're specifically actually leaving out these areas that we know to be the places where declines and conservation aspects of PICAs are some of the most important. So places where you've got these isolated mountain ranges in the Great Basin and down here in the Colorado Plateau in southern Utah and northern Arizona. So I see this as a big challenge, but also as a big opportunity to be able to reach more rural kinds of groups of people and engage them also in collecting observations of this species in parts of its range that are perhaps of the most conservation, highest conservation and management value. The good news is that when the government is not shut down, lots of federal agencies have started actually devoting specific grant funding opportunities to funding citizen science. And the EPA and the U.S. Forest Service are certainly some of the leaders in this respect. The U.S. Forest Service last year established the first citizen science competitive funding program, and our Cascades PICA Watch project did get some money from them to do monitoring after the fire. And that's something that I'll tell you guys about tomorrow in my technical talk. I wanted to sort of wrap up here with a couple of the broader benefits of participating in citizen science. One of the things that I think is a really important outcome that is really important to acknowledge is that when people participate in citizen science, they have an opportunity to actually interact with scientists who don't look like or act like Albert Einstein. Weird, right? And you don't wear like white lab coats and glasses. So this was a hashtag that was really popular on Twitter about 2 years ago, I think, that there was a public poll that showed that most people polled on the street couldn't name an actual living scientist. All they could think of was dead white guys. And so there was this sort of big campaign to sort of, you know, demonstrate to everybody that there are lots of us who are actual living scientists, and many of us are not white, male, or dead. Another, you know, sort of really, I think, broadly important outcome of participating in science, citizen science, is that fostering a sense of scientific curiosity in some social science literature has been shown to help bridge some of the partisan divides that are really clearly a big problem in our country right now. So there was a study published in 2017 that showed that people who score more highly on a scientific curiosity scale are more likely to both consider alternative political views to their own, but also to treat those views with respect. So I like to think that participating in citizen science may be helping to heal some of those divides in our country. When they're involved in science, obviously people, you know, understand science and how it is used to generate knowledge, and they oftentimes believe it to be a more credible in terms of that sources of evidence in pursuit of truth. And lastly, I just kind of wanted to end with this idea that in many ways, this isn't actually an altruistic endeavor for us as scientists. When engaging with volunteers and helping, you know, engaging volunteers in co-creating our knowledge, they can really contribute new perspectives. So some of the examples of that that I've tried to communicate to you today are, you know, fresh observations and new ideas of projects that draw on their own expertise that is different from my expertise as an ecologist. If you're interested in learning more about citizen science, which I sincerely hope that you are, I would be totally happy, of course, to answer your questions and also to chat with you more about this. I would encourage you to check out the Citizen Science Association website. They've got a lot of really nice information and resources that they've kind of drawn into one place. Twitter is also the sort of preferred venue for social media conversation about citizen science, and a couple of the key hashtags where this conversation is happening on Twitter are at these hashtags. You can follow the Citizen Science Association, and if you're interested in the conference, you can also follow the conference by following the CITSCI 2019 hashtag when that conference starts in Raleigh. So with that, I have lots and lots of people to thank. I wanted to sort of reiterate a thank you to these really wonderful teachers. I didn't have an opportunity to talk about my work with the Jane Goodall Environmental Middle School in Oregon, but that's another kind of K-12 outreach project that I've been involved with that couldn't have been done without Mr. Mike Weddle. Thanks also to folks that have been collaborators and mentors, people who have funded, and students that have participated in this. And with that, I would be totally happy to entertain any questions you may have. Yeah.
You touched on the balance between objectives in citizen science projects.
Mm-hmm.
In particular, the objective of getting really good data,
mm-hmm.
and of citizen science is staying engaged.
Right.
And I wondered if you could talk a little bit more about that, if that's a trade-off, or if there are particular qualities of programs that you've seen that have done both really well.
Yeah. It's a really good question, and I'm going to talk about this a little bit more in my talk tomorrow, because it's something that we definitely have struggled with a little bit. I personally oftentimes tend to suffer from the delusion that everything is possible and we can do all the things. Sometimes I have to sort of come face to face with the reality that I think that there can be an inherent trade-off there, but there doesn't necessarily have to be. And I think that the key to success in balancing those objectives, or maybe I should rephrase it from balance to like maximizing the success of both objectives, lies in the volunteer training protocol and in having volunteers be really invested in the success of the project. So when you can recruit volunteers and you know, make sure that they're really invested in the success of the project, and they will be more motivated, and when they feel like they really understand the importance of the project and the importance of the quality of the data, they'll be more likely to pay closer attention to those data quality issues. I think that the other aspect of that we've struggled with is even just identifying what axes of data quality do volunteers struggle with the most. So for PICAs, it's definitely the hardest one is that after they've been at a site for about 20, 30, 40 minutes and they haven't seen a PICA, they're like, I'm done, this is dumb, you know, there's no PICAs here, like, I don't want to do PICA watch anymore, you know, and so I think that there's, one of the ways that we've tried to kind of get at that is by doing some, like, divide and conquer, where we send multiple volunteers to a site to search different areas of the site so that it's not totally overwhelming, like, I have to search all of these rocks, you know, myself, but I'm doing this part, somebody else is doing that part, and somebody else is doing that part, and then, you know, they can powwow. And under the direction, sending groups out in that way under the direction of a team leader who has received some extra training and qualifications in how to both motivate volunteers to stick with it and also to oversee that they are doing the protocols appropriately. Does that make sense? Yeah, but it's definitely a big challenge, and we're working on it, and I think we're going to fix it. Yeah.
Talk about the
So, sorry, just to make sure I heard you correctly, your question is there any plans for citizen science in some of those understudied parts of the range in Idaho and Nevada? The short answer is yes. The long answer is that if people can get funding. So I have some collaborators at University of Nevada, Reno, that have submitted a couple of different proposals that would involve having citizen scientists across the range collect scat samples that could be used in genetics and genomic studies. And then as part of that, they would basically like nucleate a citizen science project based in Reno that would survey for the Great Basin. But some of the big thing is that in the places where it's not already happening, it's not happening for a reason, and that reason has to do with access and funding, because they're largely in communities where people are not seeking science experiences themselves, and it's in communities, you know, where they're oftentimes like remote and far apart. And so for like, you know, me, Pika Joe, to go visit like all of Nevada, you know, would take a tremendous amount of time and money. And so I think that what probably needs to happen there is, you know, once there's some sort of like nucleating resources that can come together with that goal, that we'll start to see that sort of thing. Yeah. Yes.
On a similar boat, and you may not be, because you're in Colorado now, but can you maybe say a little bit about the robust citizen science community in Utah?
Yes. There is a robust citizen science community in Utah. and I was really pleased to attend a little meeting about a year and a half ago, 2 years ago, of citizen science practitioners across the state that gathered at the Natural History Museum in Salt Lake City. And so there is that was a really kind of important grouping because it sort of nucleated a community of people who are already doing citizen science in Utah to kind of get together, share ideas, and figure out how their projects could really complement each other. And so there are people who are working in schools, people working with agencies, people working here up in Logan, collecting all kinds of different data. And I think that we have a Facebook group now, I don't know if there's a listserv or there's like a Google list kind of thing. I think
there is, and eventually we want to have a map, a story map kind of thing going.
Yeah.
But still not there yet.
Yeah. So eventually there's going to be a story map kind of thing of like all of the different projects. So I am sort of tangentially involved in this because for the last 3 years I've been mostly writing lectures and then delivering them and then having to write new lectures is part of my teaching job. But I am, you know, still committed to citizen science in Utah. I'm still working with these teachers in. At SLCSE, and I also have started doing research on pikas in the La Salle Mountains, and I'm hoping to incorporate an aspect of citizen science into that in southern Utah. So, all right.
With that, I would like to thank Dr. Varner for coming and giving this wonderful presentation.
Yeah.
So, thank you.
Thank you.